trust the name of Jesus. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious.
Unmatched in all your wisdom, in love and justice you will reign. Every knee will bow.
Did you bring your expectations this morning?
We bring our expectations. Our hope is anchored in your name, the name of Jesus.
Shout this out.
We trust the name of Jesus. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious.
The Word of God says in Revelation chapter 17, it says this: these will make war against the Lamb, but the Lamb will conquer them, because He is the Lord of lords and the King of kings. We serve a God who will conquer His enemies, who will reign eternal, and let's lift His name, let's lift His banner high this morning, church.
Our banner high, we lift the name of Jesus. From age to age you reign, your kingdom has no end. We lift our banner high, we lift the name of Jesus. From age to age you reign, your kingdom has no end.
You are the only King forever.
Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious.
God who has conquered in the past, and He is the God who will conquer again. And we're going to continue to sing to Him this morning. The God that no matter what we walk through, no matter the years we fought these battles, He is the God that can conquer our giants. And so let's sing this next song. It's called Do It Again.
Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall, but you have never failed me yet. Waiting for change to come, no
the battle's won. For you have never failed me yet. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed me yet. And I know the night won't. Your word will come to pass, and my heart will sing your praise again. And Jesus, you're still enough. Keep me within your love. Still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands, and this is my confidence. You've never failed. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. Still in your hands, this is my confidence. You've never failed me out. I've seen you move. I've seen you move. You move the mountains, and I believe I'll see you do it again. You made a way when there was no way, and I believe I'll see you do it again. I've seen you move. You move the mountains, and I believe I'll see you do it again. You made a way when there was no way, and I believe I'll see you do it again. I've seen you move. You move the mountains, and I believe I'll see you do it. Still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. Still in your hands. praise him this morning, church.
Go ahead and be seated, and welcome once again to Morningstar Baptist Church. I'm excited that you're here. I'm excited about what God has in store for us today. Right now, I'm going to invite everybody to pull out that connection card in your seat right now, right where you're at, and I'm going to invite you to start filling it out. And whether you've been here forever, or this is your first time here, second time here, we're going to invite you and ask you if you fill that out, and then you can drop it off in the wooden crate on your way out the back door, especially if it's your first time, because we want to mail you a gift card as our way of saying thank you for being here today. And if you're a regular attender or a member, we ask you at least put your name and your email address on there so we can keep you up to date with all the things that are going on. And again, you can drop that off back there in that crate on your way out the door. But man, we got a lot going on. Tonight, we've got the Hot Topics at 6 o'clock, and I'm telling you, you don't want to miss tonight. It's going to be our last one before we look at maybe starting up another one soon. Bring something to write with, because tonight it's going to be a grown-up conversation, and you're not going to miss it. There will be child care provided by our youth department and our youth counselors that will be back there helping watch kids. But I want to invite you to come. It's only an hour. We don't keep you forever, but I think you'll enjoy it. So you're invited to come tonight at 6 o'clock. I don't know if you've seen out in our back lot back here, but Lane planted the most amazing pumpkin patch I have ever seen, and it is growing like crazy, and we are getting ready for our fall block party. And I asked Lane, it might be crazy, but can you plant us a pumpkin patch? He's like, absolutely. So it looks awesome, and it's going so good, and we're also going to buy some pumpkins as well to help supplement that. That's coming up in October. We'll have more information about that. Just know we're getting prepared for it, and it's looking really, really good, and we can't wait to be able to just minister and love on our community that way coming up in October. But tonight, Hot Topics. Next Sunday is Youth Sunday. You're not going to want to miss it. Our youth department is going to be running things, so don't let that scare you away. They're going to be great. They're going to do a wonderful job. I'm excited about seeing God use our young people, use their talents to minister to his church. And the more we can get them involved to do that, the better. So don't miss next Sunday. If for no other reason, it's a chance for us to encourage our young people and to support them in their walk with the Lord. And so be here next Sunday. Some other stuff coming up. August 9th, we're going to have Lord's Supper. Because the whole corona thing hit, we missed having it at Easter time. And so we want everybody to be here for August 9th. This is a time, one of the things that Christ has commanded his church to do, other than meet together, is, hey, baptize when somebody gives their life to Jesus Christ and participate in the Lord's Supper until I come back in remembrance of me. And so this is something that's not a good suggestion. This is a command for the body of Christ. So we want you to be here on August 9th to be able to do that. We also have another new members class coming up on August 16th. So maybe you missed the new members class last week. You can just write on the back of your card, new member class, and we'll reach out to you and make sure we get you signed up for that. Or you can email the office and say, hey, I'd like to be a part of that, and we'll make sure you're signed up for that. This morning, it's a little different. We have with us this morning who's going to come and speak to us is Tyler Carlton. I've known Tyler for a long time. Some of our teenagers know Tyler for his work traveling with camp. Tyler is going to be a missionary to Nicaragua. And I'm not going to steal all of his thunder, but it's what he's going to be doing is something totally amazing that God has called him to the country of Nicaragua to travel around and start up and minister to the kids of Nicaragua, to start children's ministries with missionaries that are there, and just mainly reach the kids in Nicaragua for the cause of Jesus Christ. And I can't wait for him to get there. He's just starting his journey of going around and raising support so he can get to the field. And that's where we come in. Last year, we set up and created a missions budget that we'd never had before. We support the Southern Baptist Cooperative. We still send our money to them. But on top of that, we want to support our own missionaries. We want to say, hey, this is our missionary. This is Tyler. This is Brian. And eventually even send out some church planners. And so we started a missions account. And how we do this is we encourage you in your tithes and offerings, you can designate some money to go to missions. You can put $5 a month to missions, $10 a month, but you can do it online. You can write it on your tithing envelope. You can write it on the bottom of the check. It doesn't matter how you do it, but we want to be a part of missions because God is a missions God. And if we're not involved in local missions and worldwide missions, then we're not a church. We're just a club that meets together on Sunday morning. And it's our way of saying, hey, I'm going to support missionaries by taking missions trips, I'm so disappointed our trips got canceled this year because of this thing. We had two planned for this year. So next year, we're probably going to try to plan three just to try to make up for that. But another thing we use our missions budget for is to help people who want to go on mission trips that can't afford to go on mission trip. Because our goal is to get everybody in our church on the foreign field at least one time. So you can see what God is doing. So you can catch that fire and that passion for missions. And the best way to do that is get you on the foreign field. And so we use that for that. So you can be a part in helping us support missions by saying, hey, I'm just going to give a little bit to missions every month. And it helps us support missionaries like Tyler, support missionaries like Brian, and church planters both here and around the world. And we're called to do that. And so, one, thank you for being faithful through all this in your giving. And you can drop off your giving in the box on the way out the door. You can give online. But we want to, it's time for us to get back on track. Amen? It's time for us to say, hey, you know what? We get it. There's an illness going around, but it doesn't change our mandate to reach the world with the gospel of Jesus Christ. And it might take some sacrifice on a lot of our parts to do that, but we're going to do that. We're going to be obedient to the Lord, and I'm going to invite you to come along that journey with me, and let's change the world with the gospel of Jesus Christ, all right? And so I'm excited to hear from Tyler. You'll get to hear from him here in just a little bit. I'm super proud of this guy. He's amazing, and I'll let him share his story with you. But right now, hey, we're going to pray. And then we're going to keep worshiping. That's right, but before we pray, thank you. See, that's why you're here. I'm going to dismiss our kids to Kids City right now. So kids, go ahead and take off to your time of worship and your lesson time. And we're going to keep going here this morning. Let's pray. Dear Father God, we thank you for who you are, for this time this morning to worship you in our fellowship. That God, we are the priesthood of the believers, that we don't go to a priest. We don't have to go through an intermediary. That because the Holy Spirit lives in us, that each and every one of us right now, we are actively participating and leading in worship just by being here and by singing, by giving of our time, by giving of our talents, by giving of our treasure. So God, as we continue to move forward this morning, I pray that you just be with Tyler as he speaks, as he challenges us as a church to bring us back in the focus on what we need to be doing, both here and around the world. God, bless the rest of our singing as we lift up you and glorify you in everything that we do. God, protect our church. God, protect our nation. We pray that as people keep giving in, God, that we'll have a body of believers that will rise up for truth, will rise up for the gospel, and that we won't be found lacking, but God, we'll be found faithful for your glory and honor. God, just be with us for the rest of this time this morning. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Will you stand as we sing together one last song?
I've been held in your hands from the moment that I wake up until I lay my head. Oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Father, Lord, we come before you this morning and we declare that you are good. Lord, it is the desire of our life to lift your goodness that runs after us when we are so undeserving. Lord, we love you. We praise you because you are good and you are holy. Lord, we ask you to be with Tyler as he speaks. Change our hearts because of your word. It's in your name we pray. Amen. You guys can be seated.
Well, I get to go work with the Familia Avance organization in Nicaragua, which is doing some incredible work right now, but specifically I want to go in and help them reach kids. And I knew that when I was 18, I showed up in Nicaragua for the first time, and I knew right away that that was where God had placed me. I saw this country that was overflowing with kids. A third of the country is kids. A third of the country is under the age of 14. And so I saw this country that had so many kids, and not only that, had so many kids that needed to know Jesus. And I knew that that was where God was leading me to go. And I knew right away that that was where he had placed my passion. And so the coolest part to me was that not only did I get to go on that first trip when I was 18, but I got to go again and again and again. And as I was making those trips, I got to make some really good friendships on the field, some really good friendships with Nicaraguans who showed me that not only do these kids need Jesus, not only do they need to hear about Jesus, but somebody needs to show them what it means to live like Jesus. And somebody needs to show them what it looks like to mobilize your faith, to actually like use your faith in everyday life. And I knew that discipleship needed to be part of my passion. And I knew that discipleship was a part of my calling. And I think we a lot of times think about discipleship only in the context of adults and only in the context of students. And we say, man, once they've reached that age, that's when we can start teaching them. But I really just think that we need to start doing that sooner, and we need to start discipling kids sooner. And so that is my passion in Nicaragua. And it's funny because when I think of Nicaragua now and see it in the news, and I see it, you know, news stories just constantly about what is happening in this country, I see a country that is on the brink. You know, it's been ravaged by wars and fighting in recent years that have really devastated the country. Poverty is rampant everywhere across Nicaragua. There is just so many political issues on top of that. And not only that, but now very recently, they're also struggling with some disease and things like that, and sickness and natural disasters that are just sweeping across the country. And right now, Nicaragua is very literally in the hands of the next generation. It is waiting on the next generation to step up and do something to change the course of its history. What's going to happen next in Nicaragua depends on what the next generation is going to do. And so that's what I want to be a part of. I want to step in and say, man, we need to give that next generation Jesus. And not only do we need to give them Jesus, we need to show them how they can use Jesus, how they can use their faith to do those things. And so that's what I'm asking you to be a part of. I'm asking you to join me in reaching those kids. And I think the thing is, if we can reach those kids now, if we can reach them younger, if we can disciple them younger, if we can show them younger how to do those things, then we have an opportunity to change their future families. And if we can change their future families, if we can change how those families work, the actual structure of their families to be more focused on Jesus, then we're going to set Nicaragua up for long-term success. And I think if we can do that, then we can radically alter the direction that Central America is heading. Because it's at a tipping point. It's at a breaking point. And if we can reach them with Jesus now, if we can show them how to use that faith, how to mobilize their faith, how to be active, then we can change the course of history for Nicaragua and for Central America. So I want you to join me. I want you to partner with me and help me do those things so that we can be for kids, so that we can be for families, so that we can be for Nicaragua, because I think if we can do that, then we can change Central America.
Well, good morning, everybody. How's it going? Good. I'm excited to be in Ohio today and not in Missouri. I'm just excited to be out and about. I know this is a weird time in our country's history, so it's really exciting to actually get out and do stuff. I don't know about you guys, but I was getting really stir-crazy for a while, so really excited to be here. Like John said, my name is Tyler. I'm really excited to just be able to share with you guys what God has placed on my heart. I have a connection with Morningstar because of John. If you didn't know, John was my youth pastor growing up, and so I have a long connection with John and Mandy. They were kind of like bonus parents for me for a long time, and so Jonathan and Daniel and Mason are like my little brothers who I get to mess with and beat up, so it's just really fun to be around them, and you know, they are just two of my favorite people, at least Mandy is, and so just really like, you know, glad to be here, and I just love that I get to be where John and Mandy are like making roots, and I get to share with you guys kind of what's going on. So just to give you guys a little about me. I know I shared in that video kind of how God called me to Nicaragua, but I just want to let you guys know who I am as a person. I think that's kind of important before you guys just hear me talk, because eventually, you know, you're going to be like, why is this guy? Who is this guy to be telling us these things? So I was saved when I was 16. We were at camp, and I, you know, was sitting around at midnight. I had grown up in church and knew all these things and always thought I was saved. Told them when I was six, I made this big decision that, you know, I said, we got to pull over the van, and I got to pray and ask Jesus to save me. And I had just really struggled for a long time with thinking that I don't actually remember doing that, and I don't remember that being real to me, and I don't remember that being important to me. And so I was laying awake one night at camp. It was like midnight, and I went and just grabbed John and pulled him into the world's creepiest nursery, just truly the scariest place you've ever seen. And it was, I just sat there and I cried, and I was like, I don't know what I'm supposed to do with this. And so John and I, led me, and we worked out my salvation and got to spend that night saying, God, I want you to be the Lord of my life. I want you to save me. I want to follow you. And so made that decision when I was 16, and then I should have known that there was more in store for me after that, because then John, like the next week, called me into his office, sat me down and said, hey, we got to talk about what you're going to do now, because I had made this big decision when I was 13 that I wanted to do missions. I wanted to be involved in missions on a global scale, and so John sat me down and said, we're going to talk about what that actually means for you now, and so just disciple me and led me through what that looked like. But as I grew and as I kind of talked about in that video, I just developed this really big passion for kids ministry. I loved working with kids. I've served as the children's pastor at my home church for 3 years now, and I was also serving in kids ministry for about 10 years total now, so I've been around kids a lot. I am basically just a large kid. Like, that's basically like who I am as a person. I am a 6'4", 290-pound child. Like, that is like me, as you know, and so I just love working with kids, and I love getting to be around them and do stuff with them, and so I just developed this passion to teach them about Jesus, and as I did that, I realized that, man, I really wish somebody had taken that interest in me. And I don't mean that as a knock on anybody who, you know, taught me as a kid. I still go to church with a lot of my Sunday school teachers and stuff like that. But nobody ever really made it real to me. And nobody ever told me that I could do more. Nobody ever told me that as a 9-year-old, I could still do things. And nobody ever told me that as a 10-year-old, I still had the ability to be involved in missions and be involved in what Jesus was doing around the world. And nobody ever told me that. And so I just realized I had this big passion to help kids understand that. I had this passion to help kids understand that there are things they can do now, that they don't have to wait. We a lot of times think, man, once they get to high school, that's when we'll start training them. You know, once they get to high school, that's when we'll start telling them how they can do things. Once they become an adult, we can start training them how to do these things. And I want to tell you guys right now, and that's what we're going to talk about today, your kids have the opportunity to do the same thing. Your kids have the opportunity to be involved in that in a global scale, and I hope that I can encourage you today as parents, as brothers, sisters, aunts, uncles, grandparents, whoever it is, to help your kids, help those kids in your life understand that. And so we're going to be in 2 Timothy today. If you want to open your Bible to 2 Timothy, I love talking about kids and missions because I think they just fit together really well. And so, like I said, I'm a big kid, and I'm like a huge procrastinator. I don't know if you know, that's like the biggest thing I notice about kids all the time is that I'm like, hey, can you go do this? And they're like, yeah, I'll get to it. And then they wait until like the last second. I have like kind of developed a little leadership team out of some fifth and sixth graders in our kids ministry. And I'll be like, hey, I need you guys to go take care of this for me. And they're like, oh yeah, we'll get to it. And then it's about 30 seconds before that I need them to do it. They're like, yeah, we got it. You know, and they're like running to do it. And so I just have like this big, and I relate to it. I'm a huge procrastinator. I would stay up until like 3 a.m. the night before a big paper was due in college and stuff. You know, that's just what I did. And it worked out. It was fine, right? But I wish I hadn't done it. I would, like, even now working at my job at my church, I will get really caught up in doing stuff. And then I'm like, it's Wednesday night. I should probably, like, get something ready for that. Or, like, you know, it's like, I'm like, man, church is tomorrow morning and I have nothing ready. You know, like, I just am, like, a huge procrastinator. And so we look at these things and I started to realize that I'm missing out on a little bit of urgency. And I started, you know, I have people pouring in my life saying, hey, Tyler, you should probably, like, step that up. You know, you should probably like step up doing that. And I like thought about it, I was like, yeah, you know, I could probably do better at that. I could probably do better about caring about the time frame of things. I could probably do better about being urgent. And then I started to read the Bible and I got pretty convicted, because when you read the Bible, it's full of urgency. And it's full of this desire to do things quickly. And it's full of one desire in particular to do things quickly, and that's share the gospel. And we're going to see in 2 Timothy that Paul, who is writing this letter to his protege, this kid that he is raising up, he's telling Timothy that you have to be urgent. And we're going to see that he trusts Timothy to be urgent because somebody else was urgent in Timothy's life for him. And I think about it because we are all like this. We're all like this. How many of us, we start to just run out of time on a lot of stuff. And it comes up in ways that, you know, maybe we don't really expect. Maybe you're an adult in here and you're going through the month and you know you've got a rent payment coming up or a mortgage payment or whatever it is and you didn't really realize how much you had spent this month. Your budget's kind of running out and you're like, we got to pay rent next week. I don't know how we're going to do that. And you start to realize that this time is creeping up on you. Maybe you're a kid in here and you're like me and you're like, man, I'm in high school and I got a giant test tomorrow morning. I have not studied one time for it. And you realize that time is running out for you to get ready for that test. Maybe you're a parent in here and you have a kid who is rapidly approaching graduation from high school, or maybe they just graduated, or maybe you already had some kids that graduated and you started to realize like, man, time's running out for me to like teach them things. Because, man, they're going to move out and they're not going to be around me as much, and I'm running out of time to impart on them these things that I want them to know. Or, man, maybe this, and I hope this is none of you, but maybe you're like, man, my kid has not turned out the way I had hoped, and I am running out of time to fix that. You know, and like, maybe you're sitting here, and you're just thinking, I am running out of time. And Paul tells us that that's an issue we got to fix. So we're going to pick up in 2 Timothy, because we're going to pick up right in the middle of Paul's urgency. We're gonna move pretty quickly through most of the book. I'm gonna be honest with you. We're not gonna read a ton of it, so nobody freak out that I was just like, we're gonna read a 6-chapter book today. You know, like we're gonna go pretty quick through it, but we're gonna start at the beginning. We're gonna move towards the end. But Paul is in the middle of this urgency because the new church, the early church, when it started. And I know you guys are going through a series on Acts right now, so you've probably kind of picked this up a little bit over the past few weeks. But the early church was urgent. They knew that they had to go quickly. They were going everywhere as fast as they could and doing everything possible. In fact, when Paul got saved, it was only like a couple weeks before all of a sudden Paul was this like insane missionary who was traveling all over the world. Like Paul got saved, and you guys are going to hear about that, I think, in like a couple weeks probably in your series. But Paul gets saved, and then he is going. Like there is no like weight in him. There is no calmness. He is going, and Paul and Peter and John and all these guys are moving quickly because they understood that they were like, hey, Jesus said he's coming back. And we got to tell everybody we can as fast as humanly possible. Like, we are going to go. And so we're picking up right in the middle of Paul's urgency. He has planted a bunch of churches. He has gone into these towns. He goes to the synagogues, and he goes to the town markets, and he's telling everyone he can about Jesus and starting these churches, making sure they're good, and then he's out because he's got to go start another one. And in his best church, probably like the strongest church that he started, is in Ephesus. Book of Ephesians, he writes a letter to them, but Ephesus is probably the strongest church that he had, and he left somebody in charge of it. He left Timothy in charge of it. And so, obviously, Timothy's a pretty important guy to him. Timothy's a guy that he trusts, and we don't know a ton about Timothy. We know a few things. We know that Timothy was the son of a Jew who married a Greek man, so we know that his father was a Greek who probably did not believe the Bible, probably did not believe the gospel at all, but his mother and his grandmother were Jews who converted to Christianity. Okay, so we know that about them. We know that in Acts, Paul actually runs into his mom and grandma and meets them and meets Timothy as a little kid for the first time. And he's like, oh, whoa, that's cool, you know? And so we learn a little bit about Timothy and who he is. And we learn that Timothy, just based off his position, is probably a pretty smart kid. When Paul is writing this letter to him, Timothy is in his early 20s. Okay, so he's a pretty young guy. He is not an experienced dude by any means. He is young, but he seems to be capable. And so Paul trusts him, and he is Paul's protege. Paul actually brought him on his missionary journeys with him. He met Timothy as an adult after he met him as a kid, and he said, I like this guy. And he just took him with him. You know, he's like, I want this guy with me. And so he brought him around, taught him all these things. He trusted Timothy. And so Paul is writing this letter to Timothy because he knows that Timothy's going to need some encouragement. He knows that being a pastor is hard. I don't know if you guys knew that. John has a lot more gray hair now than he did like 2 years ago, okay? So being a pastor is difficult, it's stressful. So he knows that Timothy's going to need some encouragement, and he knows that Timothy's going to need some help, but he also wants to give Timothy a reminder. And so we're going to pick up 2 Timothy, I'm sorry, chapter 1. We're going to read verse 5. Start it off. He's introducing this letter to Timothy, and he tells Timothy this in verse 5. For I am mindful of the sincere faith within you, which first dwelt in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and I am sure that it is in you as well. He's telling Timothy, hey, Timothy, one of the things I love best about you is that you have real faith. You have a sincere faith, Timothy. And the reason I know, I am sure that you have a real and sincere faith is because your mother and your grandmother had it as well. And if I know your mother and grandmother, they passed it to you. He said, I am sure of that. I think I love so much about you that you have this sincere faith. And then he keeps going in verse 6 and he says, for this reason, because of your sincere faith, okay, because I know you have a sincere faith, for this reason, I remind you to kindle afresh the gift of God which is in you through the laying on of my hands. I want to remind you, I have a job to do, and you need to be doing it. Your job, Timothy, is to kindle afresh the gift of God. You need to be showing people God's gift. You need to be showing people God's presence in your life. That's your job, Timothy. And I'm telling you that because I know you have a sincere faith. So Paul goes on in his letter. Like I said, we're gonna move pretty quickly through this, and we're going to focus a lot on chapter 3, but we're going to move pretty quickly. But in chapter 2, the rest of chapter 1, Paul kind of reminds Timothy. He's encouraging him. He's telling him, he's like, hey, I really want to encourage you. Make sure you're doing your job. Make sure you are doing what you are supposed to do. Make sure that you are actually focused on those things, okay? And so he tells him, he's like, make sure the church is working right. Make sure that everybody is focused on their jobs. Make sure that everybody is urgent about the gospel. That's the thing he says over and over. In fact, in chapter 2 and verse 10, Paul tells him, he's like, I am in prison right now, Timothy. I am in prison. I'm going through all these things. People have stoned me, kicked me out of their towns, beat me up until I almost died. And he says, for this reason, I endure all those things for the sake of those who are chosen so that they may also obtain the salvation that's in Jesus Christ. So he says, I'm doing all these things because, Timothy, it doesn't matter what I go through. It doesn't matter how bad it gets for me because I have got to tell people about Jesus. It doesn't matter how hard it gets for me. I'm going to endure everything. Because I've got to tell people about Jesus, and Timothy, you've got to too. I need you to tell people. He's just encouraging him, be focused on the good things that you've got to do. And then he switches his tone in chapter 3. Kind of gets a little darker. He goes from encouraging and uplifting Timothy to all of a sudden it gets really dark, and he's like, hey, bad things are coming. I don't know if you know this, Timothy, but it's pretty rough being a Christian. I'm in prison right now, okay? You know, he's like, it's pretty tough. And I'm just telling you, bad stuff's coming. I'm just telling you that there's going to be some really difficult times. And not only is it going to be hard for you, but Timothy, it's going to be hard for the church. Because you're going to see people who are in the church who fall away. And you're going to see people who are in the church who you thought were awesome Christians. And they're going to struggle. And they're going to prove to you they probably never had faith. And he's telling them all these things. He's telling them that he's like, it is going to be really difficult. Because as we get closer to Jesus coming back, it's just going to get worse. But Timothy, stay focused. And then he tells him in chapter 3. So we're going to spend most of our time. Chapter 3, verse 14. Says this. Despite how bad it's going to get. It's going to get really rough. It's going to get tough. You're going to have to stay focused. You're going to have to work really hard. Verse 14. You, however, Timothy. You. These evil men, they're going to do things. The church is going to struggle. People are going to fall away. But you, Timothy. Continue in the things you have learned and become convinced of, knowing from whom you have learned them, and that from childhood you have known the sacred writings which are able to give you the wisdom that leads to salvation through faith in Jesus Christ. He says, Timothy, I am not worried about what's going to happen to you. Do you know why I'm not worried about what's going to happen to you, Timothy? Because you have real faith. And you have had real faith since you were a child. In fact, it's the language that Paul uses here. Jewish boys usually started learning the scripture, the Torah, at about age 5, but Paul specifically uses a word that implies infancy. So Paul is saying that before you were even supposed to start learning the scriptures, you were being taught those scriptures. And you were being taught them by your mother and grandmother who had real faith before you. He says, Timothy, it's going to get rough. Capital R-U-F-F, rough. Like, it is going to be bad. People are going to fall away. People are going to prove to you that they were not as good as you thought. Evil men are going to come. But Timothy, I'm not worried about you because you have real faith. I'm not worried about you having real faith because I know the people who taught you. And I know that they started teaching you the earliest they possibly could. Little two-year-old Timothy running around, you know, quoting Torah probably, right? Like, Timothy, I know that you've got it. Like, I'm not worried about you. And then he keeps going. This is a very famous, you know, passage in scripture right here. So you guys have probably heard this at some point in your life. But he says, I'm not worried about you because you know these things. And the reason I think it's good that you know these things is this. All scripture is inspired by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction and training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be adequate and equipped for every good work. Says, Timothy, I am good with you. Like, I trust you to take over this church. I trust you to lead them. I trust you to fight through all these bad times because you know the word of God. And the word of God is the only thing that's going to make you ready for good works. And the word of God is the only thing that's able to do that for you. And Timothy, you have been taught that from a young age. Because here's the thing, Timothy's mother and grandmother, Lois and Eunice, who are remembered forever, by the way, this is 2,000 years ago, and they get name dropped in the Bible, so that's a pretty big deal, okay? If your name is in the Bible, that's a pretty big deal, okay? They knew there was an urgency. They knew that they needed to teach Timothy as much as they could, as fast as they could. And Paul is saying, that's why you're ready. That's why I trust you. That's why you're equipped for every good work, because your mother and grandmother knew that there was an urgency. Here's the thing, parents, if you are a parent in here, a grandparent, right? He specifically mentioned the grandparent. If you are an aunt, an uncle, an older brother, an older sister, you have a responsibility to teach the people behind you. You have a responsibility to go to the younger generation, the next generation, and you have a responsibility to teach them. Here's what's happened in the church today is we've said, no, that's the church's job. We've said, you know what? I'll take them to church on Sunday and Wednesday, and they get the Bible learning they need. But what Paul is saying is, there wasn't even a church. And Paul's saying, you know what? Timothy, your mother and grandmother did the job, and they did it well. You have a responsibility to go to the generation behind you and train them and teach them. It is urgent. And I know that here's what's happened. Is when you read this, knowing that it's 2,000 years ago, I just said this is 2,000 years ago, you're going to hear that, and you're going to say, well, it's obviously not that urgent. Because Paul and the apostles and the disciples back in that day, they were running like crazy because they thought, in their minds, Jesus was coming back next month. Like, he left, he coming back, and we got to go quick. So they thought it was like next month. And so every day to them, they woke up and they're like, all right, I got to try. I got to get as many people as possible today because if I don't, Jesus is coming back. And it's been 2,000 years since then. So at this point, you may be sitting here thinking, well, it's obviously not that urgent. And I'd like to just give you a little bit of a modern context for why I still think that you should view it as urgent. You guys have probably heard the statistic before of people leaving their faith when they graduate high school. And so if you're in high school in here, perk up a little bit, okay? So you have probably heard that, right, that somewhere between, depending on what study you look at, between 65 and 80% of students leave their faith after high school. Okay, and there's various reasons for that. You know, some people attribute it to where they go to college, some people, you know, whatever. Just the statistic is 65 to 80% of people leave their faith when they graduate high school. So already we're like, okay, there's a ticking clock because we got to make sure that these kids are ready by the time they graduate high school. Well, Barna also did a study on worldview, and I think this is more important, honestly, in my opinion. But their worldview, which is obviously how you see and interpret what happens around you, how you understand struggles, how you understand, you know, good things that happen. Barna says that your worldview, everyone in general, your worldview is set by the time you are 13. So how you interpret life, how you see the things around you is set by the time you turn 13. We got a really big ticking clock now. Because here's what's happened, you're gonna hear this, and you're gonna say, wow, my kids are past 13. And you're gonna say, wow, I'm 15. You know, like you're gonna hear those things, and you're gonna say, wow, I'm past that. Don't gotta worry about it anymore. Here's what I'm going to tell you. Just because that's the data doesn't mean you can't still try. Okay, so like if you're past that, that should give you a little bit more urgency because you're like, wow, I really got to fix this now. But what I'm telling you is that you have a ticking time clock. Like it is counting down very quickly. Okay, 13. By 13, you have real, what this data is telling us is that really you have until the age of 13 to adequately prepare and train your kids in the Bible. You have until 13 to make sure that they are adequately grounded in their faith. Because If they're not, then you're going to see from about 13 to 18, you're going to see that change. And you're going to see their behavior change. And you're going to see their behavior probably degrade over time. So you have until 13, parents, to really get your kids trained and adequately prepared in their faith. And so if you're in here and you're like a high school student and you're like, I got dragged here to church today. I've been dragged here to church like every week. Like, this is not me telling you, this is not me giving an excuse for you to go to your parents and be like, look, Tyler said, you know, like you missed it. You missed that chance, okay? But what I am telling you is that if you are past that and maybe you are in here and you've been struggling with your faith, I know that in high school, I really struggled with my faith. Obviously, I didn't get saved till I was 16. So I really struggled with that. And so I understand, and maybe you're in here and you've been having those doubts and those frustrations and you've started to cement in your mind that, you know what, that's not for me. That biblical worldview, it's not my thing. I'm just going to warn you that the worldview you do adapt and the worldview that you do hold to, it's going to struggle over the next few years. And you're going to have to really be sure of that worldview because it's going to get some holes poked in it. And I'm going to give you that. I'm of the opinion that the biblical worldview is the only one that's going to stand up. And I'm of the opinion that if you're one of those people that maybe you're past that time, that point in time where it says that, you know, your worldview is set and you're starting to crumble, I'm going to tell you that the biblical worldview is the one that's going to hold up the most, so you should revisit it, okay? And if you're a parent in here, I'm also not telling you that you have just completely failed at your job, okay? I don't want it to sound like that either, all right? I don't want a parent in here to be like, well, this missionary just told me I was a crappy parent, and you know, what am I supposed to do now? Like, I missed that. Like, you know, I missed the cut, and that's not what I'm telling you either, but what I'm telling you is you need to be intentional with your time. You need to be intentional as a parent and a grandparent. And I promise I'm going to mix this with missions. I promise. So just keep with me, okay? I promise it's going to come together. But parents, what does it require of you then? What does this mean for you? If we're looking at this time clock that says by 13, they set their worldview, and by 18, they're probably leaving their faith. What does this mean for you, okay? Parents, start early. Start training your kids at home today. Okay? Do not leave it as the church's job. Do not leave it as their youth counselor's job. Don't leave it as your pastor's job. It is your job to do that. And maybe you're a grandparent in here and you know what? I've got grandkids that need that. You step up and you take that step. Grandparents, you make that move, okay? Here's a big number that honestly scares me when I hear it, and it scares most parents when they hear it. On average, your kid spends 40 hours a year in church, okay? So 40 hours a year, that's the average. That's the national average, okay? You know, maybe you're like great at this, and so you bring your kids every Sunday morning and Sunday night. They come Wednesday, okay? So you're like kind of maybe 150 hours max, okay? 150 hours max that your kid is spending in church. On average, they're spending 4,000 hours a year at home with you, okay? It's a big gap, big difference, all right? And they're spending like 1,500 hours at school. Okay, so 40 hours on average, I'm sorry, I said that wrong, 3,000 hours at home with you, okay? 40 hours on average at church, 3,000 hours at home with you. And you're going to tell me that the 40 hours is enough. This is what I have, you know, as a children's pastor, part of my job is helping parents. Part of my job is helping parents understand this. And the amount of times that a parent will call me and say, hey, on Sunday morning, could you talk to my kid about this? I get this conversation all the time. Hey, my kid is really struggling with this. On Sunday morning, would you care to talk to him? And I'm like, why don't I help you talk to him right now? Because I need parents to understand that they have a responsibility at home to do these things. We have a parent in our church. His name's Jeff. And Jeff, I started pushing this number a lot. And so I got to speak, and I was telling parents that you have this responsibility to teach your kids. And so I started pushing this number, and I told them about an app. It's called Parent Q. If you're a parent in here, it's a free app. You should download it. It's great. But Parent Q, and it puts a countdown clock until they graduate high school. So on average, a kid has like 936 weeks from the time they're born to the time they graduate high school. And it gives a countdown clock of how many weeks you have left. And so Jeff downloaded this, and he came to me, and he said, hey, I hate you. And I was like, oh, I'm sorry. Like, what's, you know, did I do something to you? And he's like, now every day I open my phone and it tells me I've only got this much time left with Addison. And I was like, well, that's good. That's what I want. Like, you know, that's I'm trying to get you to understand this. Like, so this may be hard for you to hear. Honestly, that's what I'm telling you is it's going to be hard for you to hear. But you have a limited amount of time and you need to hurry. Okay, like you have got to hurry, all right? The thing is, like Paul is telling Timothy, he's telling him like, I am not concerned about what's going to happen to your faith because I trust the people who taught you. I trust that you were raised in it. I trust that you understand it, and I trust that it's the word of God and it's going to change your life. So Timothy, do it. You know, like, do these things, all right? And so here's my other thing, parents. What does this require of you? So one, train your kids at home. Two, don't blame a generation. This is a bone to pick with me. I'm at the tail end of the millennial generation, okay? So sometimes I'm considered a Gen Z. I would never claim that, all right? You know, that's a scary thought to be considered a Gen Z, but I'm at the very tail end of millennial stuff. So I, you know, in the news, it's a big thing to be like, millennial culture, you know, and like, you know, really just trash millennials and stuff like that. Do not blame a generation for what you perceive as their failures. Do not blame an entire generation for that. Who taught that generation how to do that? Okay? I'm just going to give you a general fact about life is that the next generation is taught by the previous generation. Previous generation, you have a responsibility to teach the next generation. If you want to blame somebody, blame yourself. If you want to blame somebody because they're a kid, they don't know any better. They're a kid, they don't understand. Parents, grandparents, aunts, uncles, older brothers, older sisters, take responsibility. Take action. Do something about it because that's how you're going to fix it. Do something about it. Teach your kids the gospel. Here's what the thing, and I want to tell everybody, you know, if you're in here and you're not a parent, you're not an older brother, grandparent, whatever, you're not excluded from this, okay? You have a responsibility still to go serve yourself. Not like serve yourself, but like serve for yourself. That was a bad way for me to say that, right? Don't serve yourself, okay? Serve for yourself, right? So go and volunteer in kids' ministry. Go and find somebody that you can mentor. Go and volunteer to do all those things. Be involved in it. Even if you're, man, I don't have a younger brother. I don't have a younger sister. I don't have kids. I don't have, you know, whatever. Go be involved in it. Find a way that you can have influence in their life. Find a way that you can do those things because you need to give them the gospel. Here's what Paul says right after this. So he finishes 3:16 and 17. And in chapter 4, and we're gonna wrap up. Chapter 4, he says this. I solemnly charge you. He's talking to Timothy. He's telling him, he's like, Timothy, I trust you. It's going to be bad. It's going to be rough, but I trust you. You're not going to fail because I know who taught you. He says, Timothy, I charge you in the presence of God in Christ Jesus, who is to judge the living and the dead, and by his appearance in his kingdom, preach the word. Be ready in season and out of season. Reprove, rebuke, exhort with great patience and instruction. For the time will come when they, being the people that he's talking to, the people that he's leading, the time will come that they will not endure sound doctrine. But wanting to have their ears tickled, they will accumulate for themselves teachers in accordance to their own desires, and they will turn away their ears from the truth and will turn aside the myths. But you, Timothy, be sober in all things, endure hardship, do the work of an evangelist, and fulfill your ministry. Paul's giving him a charge. And it's the same charge that we're given today. Endure. Look, if you're in here and you are like you're hearing these numbers and these statistics for the first time, maybe, and it's probably coming as a shock. It was a shock to me when I first read all these things, but Paul is giving him a charge. He says, "Do not give up. It is going to be difficult. And you're probably going to run your head into a wall 100 times before it actually works. But do not give up." It does not matter how many times you fail. It does not matter how many times people turn away. It doesn't matter how many times they leave and don't listen to your instruction. Parents, you're probably hearing that, and you're like, yes, my child turns away from my instruction all the time, right? Like, you're sitting, it does not matter how many times. Paul says, do not give up. You endure, and you do it, because it will be worth it in the end. Can you imagine if the church did this? Can you imagine if where we're at now, if right now today the church everywhere decided, I am going to do this. I'm going to be involved. I'm going to reach the next generation. I'm going to do these things because they need to know. Can you imagine how much the world would change? Can you imagine? Because we would understand that there is an urgency to tell our kids about Jesus. There is an urgency to train our kids, to disciple our kids, and we've got to do it quick. Can you imagine the impact that would have globally? Because when you realize that your kids, your personal kids, have an urgency to hear the gospel, you realize that around the world there are kids who need to hear the gospel. You realize that around the world there are people who are missing out on Jesus because nobody told them. Because nobody cared enough to go and tell them because they didn't realize that it was urgent. Because they said, you know what, I'll do it next year. And the next year came and they're like, it's a little too expensive for me. They said, I'll wait, I'll save some money. And they waited and they waited and waited. And guess what? People are missing out on Jesus because Missions depends on us understanding the urgency of the scriptures. They need the gospel and they need it now. And it's our job to take it to them. It's our job. So here's what I want to encourage. This is my challenge for you, and we're done, okay? My challenge for you. Make that decision today. If you're a parent in here and your kids are with you, I want to encourage you that when we pray, and I know Ben's going to come up and lead a song, but when we pray and we're worshiping, pray with your family. Make a decision today that we are going to take a stand as a family, and we're going to be more intentional about this. Maybe today's the day where you decide, you know what, I have not been giving to missions, but I'm going to today. I've never cared enough, you know, to really like think about it this way, but man, I can't go myself, but maybe I can help somebody who can. Maybe today's the day that you make that decision. Pray with your family. And if you're a grandparent in here, maybe your kids are out of the house, maybe you're a kid in here and your parents aren't even here with you, make that decision today for yourself. Say, how can I have influence on the next generation? How can I show that the gospel is urgent? How can I help people understand the gospel? Make that decision today. Make that decision. Do something. Do anything. Start today, because Paul says it is urgent. It is urgent, and you have to do it quick. Let's pray. God, thank you for this reminder. Thank you for Paul. Thank you for Timothy. Thank you for Lois and Eunice. God, thank you that they took an interest in Timothy's education. Thank you that they decided that they needed to teach Timothy themselves. God, I pray that you can encourage us all to be more urgent. I pray that you can encourage us all to care more. God, we are facing a time clock. God, help us to remember that time is running out. Help us to be more involved. Help us to be focused on missions. Help us to do those things. God, we love you. We trust you. Thank you for Jesus. Thank you for his sacrifice. Thank you for his resurrection. God, none of this would matter without him. Help us remember that, God. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
And with your head bowed and eyes closed for just a moment, while the band is getting ready, we're going to worship here in just a minute. But I hope you heard through Tyler, as God was speaking through Tyler this morning, about the passion and the urgency that starts at home with us and our kids, our grandkids, our nieces, our nephews, the neighbor kids. But then what about the kids that are around the world? And I love what Tyler said in his video, the passion and the vision that God has given him, that if he can reach the generation of young people in Nicaragua, it will impact the future of that country. Not only will it impact the lives and the eternities of where those kids will spend eternity, but it could very well change the whole direction of a nation. And so what wonderful way for us as a church, be like, hey, you know what? Yeah, we're going to reach our kids here. And we're going to start in our Jerusalem right here. We're going to reach our kids. And then in part of that discipleship of our kids, bring them along and say, hey, we have a guy that is reaching kids just like you in a whole different country. Do we have that urgency? Because he's absolutely right. Paul and the apostles believed that Jesus was going to come back at any moment. And they lived that way. And even Peter wrote, there's going to come a day where people are going to scoff at the fact that Jesus is going to return. I think we're living in those days. Oh, yeah, he's not coming back. It's not even real. It's been 2,000 years. We're closer today than we ever have been. There's an urgency to raise our kids, to impact our generation here, but also we've got to keep sending missionaries around the world. And if we are not going to go, if God's not calling us to go, then we have the responsibility to verbally witness in our Jerusalem, but then be able to support and send others around the world where we can't be. And that's what it's all about. So this morning, in just a moment, I'm gonna pray, and I'm gonna, as Tyler said, I'm gonna invite you to pray for your family, with your family. I'm going to invite Tyler to come up here in just a moment, and I'm going to pray over Tyler here. And I know it's a big risk, and so I don't want you to do this if you're like, hey, I don't want to get sick. I understand that, but I'm going to pray up here. I'm going to invite you, if you want to come up here and pray over Tyler, you're welcome to do that as well. But this morning, let's not leave here the same as when we came in. There's got to be an urgency. There's got to be a passion. There's got to be a drive for our kids and for people around the world. So this morning, however God has impacted your life today, will you respond to that? Will you respond to that? Dear Father God, we thank you for who you are. Thank you again for the message that it's always good to be reminded, be challenged as parents, as grandparents, aunts, uncles, neighbors, everything. God, nobody's exempt from that. To pour in the life of the next generation. Help us to do better at that. God, I still pray right now that you even raise up some from within our congregation to be sent out around the world. That you even maybe this morning burden and call some people out. Whether it's taking a missions trip next year, whether it's to start giving to missions now, or maybe it's for them to go. And be sent out of Morningstar Baptist Church as our representative to the ends of the world. God, we know you're not done yet. Use us in this moment. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Will you stand and worship? You can stand and pray. However God's leading you this morning.